Hi everyone, welcome to our fifth lecture this semester. We are going to talk about collections and aggregates in Java 8 today. But before we start the class, some administrative information. One thing that my TAs asked me to remind you is that they have office hours on demand by appointment. Please email them for any basically scheduling of office hours. They are available. Connor, Yufeng, Garrett, Shvani, and Ratan are basically willing to meet with you for any kind of questions that you may have about the course or about computer science major in general. So today, as I said, we'll cover collections and aggregates in Java 8, and then we'll have a quiz on collections and aggregates. And we are actually going to go over the solutions of this quiz later today. Also, we have a lab today after the lecture on Java Collections Framework. And the TAs will actually cover each one of these problems and discuss how to implement them. There is a homework also due, which is posted. And if you have, again, questions about it, about the homework, please post them on Piazza. So let's start the lecture for today. I assume that by now everybody can hear me, see me, and I will check the chat if there are any questions during the lecture. Also, feel free to unmute yourself if you want to ask any questions. So last time we covered all kinds of collections in Java. And just to remind you, a few of the standard collections that we are going to use in this class are lists, array lists, and linked lists. Then there are sets and the various implementations of sets of the set interface. Basically, we have hash sets, we have tree sets, sorted sets, and so on. These are the interfaces available in Java, collection interface with its sub-interfaces, set, list, queue, sorted set, and dequeue. And these are the map interfaces, map and sorted map. And then based on these interfaces, there are the actual concrete classes that implement these interfaces. So set and hash table are implemented by hash set, is basically a hash set concrete class. Tree set is implemented using a balanced tree, and it basically implements an efficient ordered set. A linked hash set implements a hash set using a linked list. Again, it implements the linked list, and it also implements the set interface. Lists are implemented by the concrete list, array list, and linked list. And basically, the difference is that one is implemented with an resizable array, and the other one is implemented with a link, a list, or basically a sequence of elements in the list which are linked through a reference. And we are actually going to implement it later this semester. Queues are implemented by array dequeue, which is implementing using a resizable array, or linked list. And actually, that's the one that we covered, which is basically implemented by a linked list. Then the map interface are implemented by hash map, tree map for balanced tree implementation of a sorted map, and linked hash map, which basically it's a hash map implemented with linked list. So these are the main classes that you can use for any kind of problem that you want to implement using these collections. Now, when we talk about collections in the Java Collection Framework, there are multiple ways to traverse the collection. And one is by using iterators, either explicitly with a while, has next, and then next to get the next element, or with a for each construct, which internally uses the iterators, using aggregate operations, which is the topic of the class today. Since Java 1.8, it's actually the preferred method of iterating over a collection. by obtaining a stream and performing aggregate operations on it. And that's the topic of the class today. Basically, there are a new syntax which was added in Java 1.8, in which aggregate operations are used usually in conjunction to functions that are called on the elements of those aggregate operations. In this case, for collection aggregates, these are lambda expressions to make the program more expressive using less lines of code, and we'll see an example below. And the following code actually iterates through a collection of geometric object shapes and prints out the red objects. And what are we doing is the following. If for any subclass of collection interface, you can obtain either a stream or a parallel stream. These are basically the new idea of collections. And really what a stream is a sequence of elements, but is different than a list or any kind of other kind of sequence. It's really a stream that obtains, you can obtain elements from that stream on demand. Now, from that stream, we can filter the elements on, and now we actually pass a Java lambda expression, an anonymous function. For every element in that stream, we apply the filter on the following function. And the function says that the color of the element is equal with the color red. That basically means that for those elements for which this condition, this equality is true, we are going to keep the element in the stream. So the result of filter is also a stream, which now contains only the elements that are red. Next, the filter is plugged into a for each function. And the for each function is basically a function that is applied on the stream. The for each function also takes another function, basically a lambda function, as a parameter. And this lambda function says that for every element of the stream, print the name of that element. So basically this sequence, this pipeline of operations starts by creating a stream out of the collection. And then on each element on the stream, basically filtering if that element out if it's not of the color red, and then for the remaining elements printing out the name of those remaining elements. So really you can implement this stream function class yourself. It's quite easily, you create a stream that encapsulates in a reference a collection, and then you have all of these methods. The filter method can be implemented by, you take another lambda expression function, which is really an interface. You take an interface that implements a single function that checks if the color of the object is red. So the filter really takes a Boolean resulting function, which takes a single element as the parameter and keeps in the stream the elements for which this condition is true, and eliminates those, removes the ones that for which the condition is false. The for each function basically calls the system.out.println on every element getName function. Finally, there is a fourth way to traverse elements in a collection through indices, but it only works for lists, because lists basically are the only ones that have indices, array lists, linked lists. Linked lists actually do not have indices, so it's really array lists only. Okay. So to understand better what collections do, I will actually show you a larger example. So suppose that you are creating a social networking application. This is quite a popular application these days. Every person has a name, a birthday, gender, email address, and many other fields. And then you have accessors for all of those methods. Get age returns the age, get name returns the name, and so on. Now, how can you create first a stream out of this collection? Let's assume that you have an array list of such persons, roster. And for the roster, you can print out the names for all of the members in that roster in a for each loop. Or you can do it with a stream aggregate. And first, you basically obtain a stream out of the roster. And then for each element of that stream, you print out the name of that element. Okay. Before we go to that to the next example, I actually implemented this specific example in a kind of similar way. So I implemented a person that has name, birthday, gender, email, and age with all of the constructors and accessors necessary. The type of basically sex, gender is basically sex, male and female. It's really that I want to show an example of an enumeration. You can put other basically values. Then I create a roster, which is an array list. And in that array list, I add multiple people like Abe, Barbara, Chris, Dorothy, Eugene, Fabian, and so on. And here we see the example, roster.stream for every element, invoke the system.outprintln method, which basically prints all of the elements in that roster by using an aggregate and a pipeline. And another example in which I filter out, I filter on the elements whose gender is male, and for every element I print those elements. And this is basically what I'm doing if I run this program. So first it prints all of the elements up to Fabian, and then it prints only those that are for which the gender is male. Okay, this is just an example. You can play with it if you want. I will post the sources on Piazza after the class. But you can do much more than that. You can actually, there are a lot of operations, aggregates that you can do in Java. Let's see a couple of more examples and then we return back to actually see how is this implemented, what is a pipeline, what are starting operations, intermediary operations and terminal operations, and basically more examples. So how do you sum the salaries of all the employees if you basically have a collection of employees? First, total is an integer value, is assigned employees.stream, which creates a stream out of the entire collection, then .collect. And for every single employee, what happens? The collector's summing int will sum all of the salaries for the employees. So there are a couple of things here which are new to you. First of all, is this a reference to a method within a class? So it is like a lambda function, but it's already a function that exists. So what this does, it generates a reference to the method getSalary from the employee class. So if employee is a class that has a getSalary method, this will use that getSalary method, employee colon colon getSalary, as the reference, as a lambda expression, as an anonymous, as a function, really a reference to a function that is passed to summing int. And summing int basically invokes this and it creates the collect is basically a function that in Java aggregates, which basically for every element of the collection, it takes in this case the integer salary, if that was, you can do summing double if it's a double, but really what this does, it sums all the integer salaries into one single value. Collect and reduce are basically two functions that we'll learn later. They are functions that basically you can give what is the operation that is done for every element, what is the initial value, and in cases that at the end you have to do something with the value, was a terminal function. So collect may take multiple parameters. And in this case, the only parameter that actually takes is the increment, which the middle operation, what happens for every element, it puts the sum of it puts the salary into the overall sum. A simpler example is the one below. We take the elements from a collection and we convert them all to strings. And this is done through the map operation. So the map operation on the collection takes a function that basically applies this function to string. So it applies the object to string function on every element of the collection. And in the case of map, it creates another stream with actually the strings which are obtained from that collection. One advantage of all of this is that you actually don't materialize this stream up to the last step. And in this case, the last step is to join all of the elements together into a long string separated by a comma space. So it's similar to the previous example. It ends with a collect operation, which takes all of the elements and applies one function on all of the elements to obtain, in this case, a single string. The map operation is even more interesting because it takes a function, a reference to the toString function in object as an argument, and applies that function on every element of the stream to create a new stream on which basically every element is a string. Now, as I said, the interesting part about streams is the fact that up to the last operation, the terminal operation, nothing is materialized. So in fact, you don't call the toString method on all of the elements of the stream to create a stream of strings. You will only call the toString method when you start collecting them right at the end. So that's the interesting part of how these are executed. So a stream is not a collection. It doesn't create a collection up to that terminal operation that collects all of the elements. Now, one other advantage of streams is that there are two functions stream. One is the sequential one, which assumes that this operation is done on a single computer with a single core, or basically in a single thread. But the other one is when you can create a parallel stream. So let's assume that your computer has enough cores to run both operating system and your Java program. Like, for instance, we have a few computers with 96 cores or a huge, relative big number of cores. And from the collection, we create a parallel stream that basically all the elements are distributed to the cores, and in this case I filter on all of the elements that are red, so only those elements that are red are kept in the stream, and then I print the names for all of those elements. One feature of parallel streams is that it doesn't keep the order anymore, so when we execute the terminal operation, like for each at the end, it can print the elements in different order as they were basically in the original stream, in the original collection, no matter what that collection is. Okay, so now let's define the theory of what exactly Java aggregates are. First of all, a pipeline is a sequence of these kind of aggregate operations. For instance, we want to print the male members contained in the roster, like we did in that previous example. The pipeline consists of two aggregate operations. So after we create a stream, filter to filter the elements that are not male outside, and for each remaining element, it prints out the name. It's really similar to a nested for loop. Basically, you have for every person in the roster. If the gender is male, you call the getName method on it. So it's kind of for each, but it's a different syntax, and in fact, it's implemented differently and more efficient in some cases. So the complete program that I showed you earlier is actually in the lecture notes. Person is the class with basically all the properties of a person. And then I create an array list and I populated one by one with different people: Abe, Barbara, Chris, Dorothy, Eugene, and Fabian. Out of which Abe, Chris, Eugene, and Fabian are of person sex male. Then I create two streams. The first stream for every element, it basically prints the name of that element. And the second stream, it filters on only the elements that have the gender equal with sex male. And then it prints out the name of those elements with for each function. So a pipeline is a sequence of aggregates, and it consists of a source, which can be a collection, any type of collection, but it can also be an array, a generation function that basically generates elements on demand, an input-output channel like system in. Basically, it's a source of any kind of inputs. And this is not a new idea. Streams are as old as computer science. In C, you have streams. Input-output streams like read and write to the command prompt or to files. But this is applied to collections, data structures, in particular in Java. Then you have zero or more intermediate operations, such as filter, map to int, and so on, that produce a new stream. So the input is a stream, which is a sequence of elements, but unlike a collection, it's not a data structure that stores elements. It's basically just a wrapper class that carries basically from the source elements one by one through the pipeline. So really up to the last operation, you don't materialize the stream. You just wait until you have the last operation and then you start applying the methods sequentially on the elements of the stream. After the intermediate operations, you usually have a terminal operation. And the terminal operation example could be for each. It basically produces something that is a non-stream result, such as a primitive value or like a double value, a collection, or in the case of for each, nothing at all. It basically prints out it for each element, executes a method. And that's what it basically does. And the parameter for this, for each operation, is a lambda expression, or it can be a reference to a method inside the class. Okay. In our case, in our example, for every element, we would print the name of that element. So basically, it's a lambda expression, the E arrow, which invokes the method getName for every object E. Java, both the compiler and the runtime, infer the type of E as being a person. And really, the way that it works is that roster is an array list of persons, so the type is propagated through generic classes, which we already talked about from the previous class. So another example, map int is an intermediate operation. It takes every element in the original stream and calls a method usually in a lambda method or a method from that class to get an int out of the follow-up stream. Also, we have an example here of method references like person get age. So first, let's start with an example. We want to calculate the average age of all the male elements in the roster collection. So we have a social network, and we want to find out the average age of men or the average age of women in that collection. And first of all, we create a stream out of the roster, which is that array list. We filter on those elements whose gender is equal with sex.male. And then for every element, we invoke the method getAge. So this double column basically creates a reference to a known method, a named method in the class person. So map to int is just the standard map function, which map like a hash map. You get a key and it returns a value. So key value pairs. map to int in particular expects the value to be of the type integer. So in this case, from that stream, it invokes the getAge method and it creates a new stream of ages. Now on that new stream of ages, we apply the average method. So the average method is basically an end terminal method. It creates a double out of that, but a double basically object, bind object. Now, get as double is the last method. It's basically a method that out of that average stream object, it creates a single double that is assigned to average. So let's talk about some of these methods that we see here. First of all, the map to int operation returns a new stream of the type int stream, which is a stream only of integer values. So the input, basically, if you think about this as a pipeline, it takes a list of elements and it returns the ages of those person elements. So the operations basically and map applies a function on each element of the particular stream. So this is an example of a higher order function. A map always takes another function as a parameter. And we will actually learn in a simpler language in SML towards the end of the semester a map and basically functional programming. Probably I will have an earlier class on functional programming because this is quite an important feature and now it's covered in CSC 260. Now, the next thing that we see here is the fact that we can get a reference to a function defined in a class. So this person get age is a method reference. This double column allows us to give to the map to int function the function get age from the person class. So it's basically a syntax that allows us to reference a method inside the class. Okay. And finally, basically, the fact that we can replace this person get age to actually e arrow e dot get age. So really, this whole, let me actually copy this. So duplicate slide. Alternatively, you can basically, this can be applied. And let me show you an example. So alternatively to this, you can basically have E arrow E dot get age. So it's really what this is, the lambda expression that says for every element, return the age of that element. I misspelled it. It should be get age. Any questions by now? This should be new to all of you. Good. Okay. So in JDK, there are many terminal operations. Average is one of them. It returns the value, one value by combining all the content of the stream. In this case, it basically takes a stream of integers and creates an double out of it, the average. There are other such operations, such as sum, to sum all of the values in the stream, mean, to compute the minimum out of the values of the stream, max, to compute the maximum, and count. So these are called reduction operations. They basically take a stream and return one value as the result. And here is that example that basically gets the average out of a stream of people that are of sex male. So first of all, it calculates the average from an int stream. So it expects the input to be a stream of integers. The second thing is that it returns an object, a special object of a type called optional double. And the reason for that is that what if the stream has no elements? So then the average returns an empty instance of optional double instead of actually returning some kind of or triggering an exception, because when you try to do an average of an empty set, you will have to divide by zero the count, and that division by zero is not defined, it's infinity. So really, basically, it's optional double is a special object that is, if it doesn't contain any elements, the stream, then you are still basically getting a null. Otherwise, it returns or an empty instance of optional double. And on optional double, if you really want, you don't have the unwrapping, unboxing by default, you need to invoke the method get as double. And if it's empty, then it will throw an exception, no such element exception. So you have to basically consider some interesting features of strings, that it also tries to avoid illegal operations, like average on a stream that contains no elements. So there are differences between aggregates and iterators. Aggregates do not contain a method like next to instruct them to process to the next element in the collection. Aggregates can more easily take advantage of parallel computing. Parallel streams are basically streams in which the next element, each element may be given to any one of the multiple threads that are running in parallel. And the idea is that in the end, the combined result, if you have a terminal function that combines these operations, will combine the results from all of the threads, from all of the subproblems. Also, aggregate operations, you can't apply them directly on a collection. You have to get a stream out of that collection. They are also called stream operations because they apply on streams only. Aggregates support behavior as parameters. We can specify lambda expressions as parameters to functions for most aggregate operations. So basically, we pass in functions as arguments to these other functions, similar to what we discussed last semester when we talked about JavaFX, that basically what you want is a handle method, but you can implement it by creating a class that extends event handler, or you can create an anonymous class that implements a new event handler subclass, or with a lambda expression where the inferred handler is already inferred from the type of handle method, the parameter of handle, and then you are just passing what is the method handle for that specific class. So on event, it basically calls that method handle or the method that is passed as a parameter. So it's just another application of having functions as parameters in Java. So the JDK also provides us with general purpose reduction operations. And there are two reduction operations, reduce and collect. Reduce is basically a function that is applied on a stream. And in this case, it's applied on an integer stream, because for every person, we got the integer age, the get age of that person. And reduce has, in this case, two parameters. It basically, what is the start value? And what are we going to do for reducing? You have the age that was collected from all of the previous elements, the current age, and what will be the reduce operation. Basically, the reduce operation in this case is that A plus B is computed, and now the new stream will have, basically, it's the new result will have the sum, the total of all of the ages. It's really similar to the same function that we had above, but replacing the reduce to sum, just the sum function. So it's basically a general function that reduces the entire stream to a single value. And what did it need? It need, how do we start with zero in this case? And how do we combine the previous value that was computed for the previous part of the stream with the new value that comes as an input. And that's exactly the parametric function that we get. The function that we get next is a lambda function that takes the previous value, the current value, and computes the sum for them. You can't implement with such a reduce average, because average, basically, you can compute the sum, but then you have to divide it by the count. You can't do it incrementally as you iterate through the elements, because you really need two values to remember, the sum and the current count. So you can do the division at the end. Collect is the other generic general purpose reduction operation. So collect modifies an existing stream. It considers how to find the average of the stream. It requires two pieces of data, the total number of values and the sum of those values for an average. You need to divide the sum by the count. We can create a new data type that contains the member variables that keep track of the total number of values and the sum of those values. So basically, you can create averager that implements an int consumer, which basically has two methods. The average, which basically, if the count is greater than zero, it divides the total with the count, or it returns zero. Accept, which basically increments the total. So accept is done for every element. And we started with the total zero, and then for every element we add the current element to the total. And this is what accept does. Basically takes the next element as an input and it adds it to the total and increments the counter. And combine, which takes an averager object and the total is incremented with the other total, the other averager object's total, and the count is incremented with the other count, the other object's count. So really these are methods which are required for collect. And then collect basically can use them. So in this example, we try to use the collect method to calculate the average for all of the males. So everything up to the collect is the same. We filter on the males and we invoke the age, get age method, so we can get a stream of ages. Now, collect takes three parameters. It takes the new operator, which creates an object of this averager that we saw before, this object. The accept method, which basically is this accept method, what happens for every element? It's added to the total and we increment the sum with one. And the combine method. The combine method is basically if you get another stream of the same kind averager, how do you combine the two streams? And really it's easy. You sum the totals and you sum the counts. And that's basically it. So the collect method does this at the end. It creates an averager object. It for every element, it accepts the elements by adding them to the sum and the count. And then in the end, it combines all of the elements in the aggregator to divide to obtain the average. Okay. So we can use these collect operations with parallel streams. So streams don't have to be just sequential streams. With parallel streams, it creates a new thread whenever the function combinator function creates a new object. So such that the averager object in this example. So basically, for a new object created for basically the collect method, it creates a single thread. So we don't need to worry about synchronization. So the collect operation takes three arguments. The supplier, which is a function, factory function, it creates a new instance of the result container. In this example, it's an instance of averager. Accumulator, which basically it's the method that incorporates a stream element in the current result. In this method, it modifies the averager result container by incrementing the count and the total with the value of the element. And combiner, which basically takes two result containers and merges them into with their content. In this example, the averager container, it increments the count variable by the count member variable of the other averager and adds to the total member variable the total of the other Avenger object, total Avenger variable. So here is an example in the collect. The collect is basically for getting collections. And here we basically have, we filter on males, we map to names, and then collect takes the input of, as an input, the to list method in collectors. So basically in this case, we the collect is done by basically creating a list out of the elements left in this stream. So out of the roster, we create a new list, which basically is the list of all the name male members of collect. And that's a list of strings. So collect doesn't always end up with a single int or double. It may end up with a collection itself. So in this case, it's a list of strings. So this version of collect takes one parameter of type collector, which is basically obtained from the this collect collectors at two as at least. The collector class contains all of these reduction operators like toList, which basically summarizes the elements into some collection that we saw before, in this case as a list. And that's exactly what I'm saying next, that basically what I did here is I basically use the toList to create a list as the result of collect, the final step. Grouping. So one thing that if you know databases, all of these features that we are talking about streaming are actually inspired by relational databases. Because in relational databases, SQL language, we have group by, which allows you to basically compute, let's say, the average age of all the women and the average age of all the male into one single statement. Because you group all of the women, all of the men, and then you apply the averagers, the aggregates on all those collections and obtain different values for each. So how do we do that? Okay. So the collect method can take as a parameter group by. So basically now the group by will match a person's sex with the list of people in that specific collection that are of that sex. So this group by operation, also part of collect, returns a map whose key values are the result of applying the lambda expression, which get gender, specified as a parameter in this case. And in this case, basically there are two genders and it will split the collection into basically male and female, and male will have the list of all the elements that are of sex male, female are all of the list of all of the elements of sex male. Okay. Another example, much bigger. And
I have a quick question, if you don't mind.
Go ahead.
So when you're declaring the map, is there a reason why you pass the person.sex class as a parameter?
This is a generic map. So basically what I'm doing here, I'm specifying that the keys. So I can leave it empty. Basically the grouping is the one that does the splitting on what is the keys, the sex, and the values are a list of persons. Really, the only thing I'm doing here is that I'm giving actually an apparent type to by gender. I'm telling that the keys are of the type sex and the values are of the type list person. But
so
this
do you
is
run into the issue of, since there are only two sexes that go from, would you run into the issue of the same sex key running in, or mapping to the like multiple people?
No. Because you see the get gender will always return one value. So for one object, it's a function, like functions in math, mathematics. It takes every value in the domain and generates a single value in the codomain. So in the codomain, there are basically two genders and every element that comes in the stream will be either a male or a female. In this case, you can add other genders, but basically the idea is that you can only have one gender, declared gender, whatever it is. And the UI does this split on the elements. And it one thing is that it's a collect method, so it's a terminal method. So it doesn't create a stream with something like groups of objects. No, it actually, it's a terminal method which creates a hash map. For every key, in this case, for every sex, the list of people in that sex group. Another example, and this is much bigger. Basically, collect, again, is the terminal operation, but now group by takes multiple parameters. It takes the gender, and then a mapping that for every name of the person, it creates the list. It is the names of every member in the collection roster and groups them by gender. So in this case, basically, I'm getting a list of persons as the output. But in this case, I basically, for every person, I get the name of those persons. And I'm applying mapping again to it. So for the resulting list, now it basically for all the names are collected into a list of strings. So the group by operation may take one parameter, as we saw in the previous example, or two parameters, a classification function, and another collector that now applies the collector mapping and applies the mapping function. So in this case, basically you have the mapping function for every person gets the name, and all of the names are collected out into a list. Retrieving the total age of all the members of each gender. So now basically we dig more for every sex group, like male, we want the total age of all of the males, the sum of all of the ages of males, and similar for female, the sum of all of the ages of female. So the total age by gender is, again, we transform it to a stream, then we invoke collect, group by to group by gender, and then a reduce operation, which starts with zero, and for every person, it gets the age, and the terminal operation is the sum. So group by, in this case, takes three parameters. Identity, the value that it starts with. So in this case, the initial value of zero is basically there were no elements at the beginning, and therefore the sum is zero. Mapper, which is the reduce operation. Basically, we usually don't want to run that collection aggregate on the original elements. So basically, in this case, it calls for every person the get age, and it creates a new stream of ages. And finally, the operation function, in this case, sum, that reduces the map value. So we are getting the sum of all of the ages in the collection. Now, let's do a quiz. And I will actually go over the quiz myself. And first of all, let's start summarizing everything that we knew in collections. So there are four main interfaces, four core interfaces: sets, lists, queues, and maps. And each of them has its own functions, which are specific for that specific collection in Java. Now, we have multiple assignments. Let's say that we have a company, Whimsical Toys Incorporated, and we want to record the names of all of the employees. And every month, we want to choose randomly an employee to receive a free toy. Now, how to implement this? With a list, because basically you need to randomly choose an element of the collection. No matter which collection you have there, you have an internal order. So if you have a set, in order to get a random element, you have to iterate through the objects, random number to get the random element. But it's easier with a list to just generate a random number from 0 to the size of the list minus 1. And then that run that gives us an index into our list. Now let's say that our company has decided that each employee will be named, each product will be named after an employee, but only the first names are used. So employees have first name, last name, middle name, and each name will be used only once. So we have an array list that contains all of the employees, let's say, and now we want the set of all of the first names. So basically, what we can do, we can iterate over the employees, whatever they are stored in. They can be stored in a list, they can be stored in a set, and then we can get the first names and add them to a set, and only unique elements will be allowed in the collection. So now if I want to name my products, I can iterate over the names in this set and basically collect, name every product after one first name of the employees. Next one. Our company decided that it only wants to use most popular names for the toys. So let's say that we have John, and that's a very popular first name, and we have Paul, and that's less popular. There are fewer Pauls in the world than Johns. So now we need a counter for all the first names. So basically we will use a map, hopefully a tree map. So it's already sorted by, actually that will sort it by the names. So we use a map first, basically for counting for every, so basically we want, let's say that we had an array list that contains the first names. So names, and this was collected somehow from the first names of our roster. So if we have a roster, then we get a stream out of it, and for every element we basically collect it, map for every element we would get the get first name. And then we need to collect them as list. And that will give us an array list of, or actually a list of the first names. Okay? First names. Excellent. Now we want to basically also iterate again so we can get the counts. So for every person, key in the roster, original roster, will basically, let's create a map that string integer. Okay. And we basically, let's call it first name counts, and it's a new hash map. And now if our first name counts this, because I will use it a couple of times, contains already our person P get first name, and we can add it to our, basically we need to get the previous counter, so integer count is first name counts dot get of p dot get first name. Then we'll put it back. So first name counts dot put for this key, p.getFirstName, we are going to put count plus one. Okay. Else, that means that it's not there yet, so we can just put one. So first name counts, we'll put the first time that we encounter that name, we put one in the collect, in the map. Okay. So now basically we have a map of all the name, the names and their counts. Now basically if we want the most popular names, we'll basically have to find to sort that map by basically the counts. Okay, so that can be done with a sort. Basically you can collect all of the counts and then sort them, and then you basically have to iterate through the map to get the ones that have the highest numbers. You can think about how to do that, but more efficiently. But one way is to just collect the counts, the key, the values. So basically, let's create a list of integers. And from this list of integers could be first name counts of get values. And then you can sort that list actually we didn't name it, so we need this counts, and then you can actually iterate through it. So for every integer C in counts, you can now basically get whose name basically correspond to that integer. So now you basically have to iterate through the hash map. So let's actually create another list of first names, which is first name counts get keys. And then for every count, you basically have to iterate through the keys for every string S. Let's call it first name in the first names. If in our case the count is equal with first name counts dot get first name, and it's one of the most popular ones. So let's say that system dot and first name. Now this basically what this does, it prints them in order of most popular first names, and that's basically it. Okay, good. What about, let's say that our company acquires season tickets to a local lacrosse team to be shared by the employees, and we want to create a waiting list for this popular sport. So normally we should use a queue. And basically, as employees are hired, they are added to this queue. First in will be the one that will get the ticket, and it gets eliminated, removed from the queue. So every single employee, in order of the, how they were added, they will basically get tickets for the next game, maybe after the pandemic. Okay. So in aggregate operations, a sequence of aggregates is called a pipeline. Intermediate operations, so a pipeline contains zero or more intermediate operations. It ends up with a terminal operation. What kind of operation produces another stream as its output? Intermediate operations, they take a stream, they create a new stream. Describe one way in which for each operation differs from the enhanced for loop or iterators. For each aggregates, let the system decide how to iterate. If you have a parallel stream, you basically will iterate in some order on the different threads on the elements of the collection, of the stream, in fact. And basically, you focus on what to do in that iteration, not to how to iterate through the elements. So it's really an idea that came from declarative programming, like logic programming or functional programming. A stream is similar to a collection in which is a data structure. It's not true, it's false. Unlike a collection, a stream is not a data structure. It doesn't create a materialized object like a data structure. It's basically it carries a value from the source to the terminal operation. So it really is lazily applied. It's applied at the end when you want to obtain the value out of the terminal. So it's different than collections. Identify the intermediate and terminal operations in this code. So filter, map to int are intermediate operations, and the terminal one is average. And average produces, as you saw in the lecture notes, an optional double. And from that optional double, we get the double that is obtained out. But really, this is a terminal operation. You are not obtaining a stream out of average. This code, what does P arrow gender equals sex male is? It's a lambda expression, is an anonymous function that is created on the spot and passed as an argument to map in this case. Person colon colon get age is a method reference. You are getting a reference from a method already defined in a class. And again, you're passing it as a parameter to the map operation. The terminal operations combine the content of the stream and return one value, and they are what kind of operations? They are called reduction operations. And those reduction operations can be average, sum, count, and so on. Name one important difference between reduce and collect. So reduce create one new value. When it produces an element, it basically just adds that element to the current reduce, and collect modifies the existing value. So collect can even be a list. So you are collecting all of the elements from the stream into a list. And this really, it mutates the existing value of the list by adding another element to that collection. So reduce usually applies our operations, then you get a single value at the end, and collect, you get a collection at the end. If you want to process the names of males and store them into a list, would you use reduce or collect? And you are using collect, because at the end, you basically will not reduce the stream to a single value. You are collecting the elements from the stream into a list. And that's the main difference. That's when you see the difference between reduce and collect. How would you write this for loop, for if, and then print out into a stream, into an aggregate? As roster.getStream of roster.stream, and then filter on males, and for each one, print out their names. Similarly, I'm giving a big code. How do you transform this one, which basically what it does for all the albums, if it's Boolean favorite is false, for all of the tracks, if the rating of the track is greater than 4, then has favorite is true and break. So basically it finds the tracks that have rating more than 4, and then that album becomes a favorite. And the album is added to the favorites albums. So how do we do it with collections? And then I sort them into basically with a comparator by names of the albums. All of this can be done into one single statement with collections. So for albums, I create a stream. I filter on all of the albums for which the tracks will basically have, they have more than, at least one track you have rating greater than 4. Then you use a sorted to actually create a sorted collection, a sorted stream, and then you collect the result into a list. So these are operations which, again, what they are doing, one of them is like an if statement, and it checks if there exists at least one track which has a rating greater than 4. Sorted actually creates from one stream of unsorted elements with a comparator method. It basically creates a stream of sorted elements. So again, it doesn't materialize up to the end, because at the end it will sort them. It will materialize the stream and then sort it. And then we are collecting from the stream into a list the result. So it's really 3 steps, filter, sort, and collect. Now, you plan to write a program using this interfaces, core interfaces, set, list, queue, and map, and which concrete classes would you use for each one of them? So the interface set is usually you use a hash set. For list, you use array lists, depending on the operations that you do in the list. If you are actually going to do updates in the middle of the array, you should probably use a linked list, because it gives you higher performance. For queues, because you eliminate elements from the beginning and you add elements at the end, you are going to use a linked list. By adding elements at the beginning, you will have to shift the entire array list if you would use an array list. And for maps, you usually use hash maps, unless you want to keep also a sorted order of the elements, and you would use a tree map in that case. If you do want to have sorted sets, you would use tree sets, and then you can sort them by anything that you want, including by passing a comparator object. Which class do you use to access wrapper implementations? You can use a collection class, which provides static methods to operate on and return collections. So these wrapper are basically those S lists. Like basically you create for a collection, for a stream at the end, a new collection. And usually those are in collections, those wrapper implementations like S-list. We saw one right here and many others previously. And in the end, this 19 problem, I didn't actually add it to the quiz. Well, I wanted to implement an entire program using buffers to read from a file and basically compute a final value of repeats at the end. This is not included in the quiz. I have it in the solution, and I posted it in Piazza, but you basically can read it on your own. Okay. One question by Brandon is, can you elaborate between stream and parallel streams? So stream basically guarantees the order. So for instance, in this example that we have here, by creating a pure stream, you basically will get the same order of results as you had in the original stream. If you use a parallel stream, so here we will use parallel stream instead of single stream. This does not guarantee the order. So I'm actually quite curious if I get a different order, and you do get a different order. So the reason for that is that my processor has four cores, and basically, actually on Windows, it actually runs on eight different cores, because by default, you would run two threads on the same core. So which means that there are eight cores that are running in parallel, and parallel stream will actually create eight threads and run and distribute the collection on the eight different threads. So parallel stream does not maintain the order, but for big collections, because now you are using N cores for running the program, you would basically get better performance. So let's say that you want to compute an average, and for that you need the sum of the elements. And let's say that your collection contains a million elements. If you do sum over the million elements, you will have a cost of a million sums. If you distribute it to four cores or eight cores, your speed up can be eight times faster, because you're running them on different processors. So that's the main difference. Basically, the only problem, as you can see in this example, is that you don't maintain the order, because each core can be scheduled on at different time. And we will talk about more about multithreading at the end of the semester. I have a lecture on that, unless I eliminated it, because it's now not covered by I eliminated it, but I can add it back. Basically, how does multithreading work in Java? And the way that it works is that you implement an interface, runnable, that allows you to basically open multiple threads for every one of the tasks that you are opening. And then each one runs on a different thread. Threads are scheduled by the operating system on different cores at different times, for different amount of times. So if you have a large amount, a number of cores, like in my case, I have eight, or we have servers with 96 cores in the department, you can basically speed up your operation eight times or 96 times and so on. I believe the difference is that parallel streams takes advantage of multithreading. Theodore, you are completely right. White map is one with the key value pairs. Yes. Okay, good. So that's basically it. That's the class today. Next, please do the lab for the day. Don't take the solution of the quiz that I posted on Piazza and read it, and make sure that if you want, you can read it, but solve the quiz four that is posted, but then start working on the lab. And as soon as the TAs join the meeting, I will ask them to basically iterate to work on the lab with you. Okay. So any questions? Any one of the TAs are here?
Yufeng's right here and now.
So as soon as you want, please, you can solve some problem of the lab, either from problem two or problem one or problem three or problem four. Which one do you want? Which one would you like to solve?
I think we agree on last time that the PhD TA for one, I will work on the two. And then the master will be working on three.
Okay, sounds
then,
good.
Yeah.
So as soon as Swani joins and Ratan joins, basically you can share your screens and show the solutions, how you would implement those problems.
I think I could begin with my second problem right now. Okay. I was kind of working on it, but yeah. I guess I could start with second question first.
Let me stop the recording for the lecture, and then we'll start the second one for the lab. Is that okay with you?
Yeah, that should be fine.
Thank you.